I think we may begin. It's just past 4:15. I'm Mark Elliott. I'm the director of the Fairbanks Center for Chinese Studies at Harvard, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to the 2014 Charles Neuhauser Memorial Lecture. And our speaker this year, of course, is Kevin Rudd. Before I give further details about the speaker, and as people continue to drift in from what's a really strange May or even June day outside, I want to say a word or two about the lecture series, about the gentleman for whom the series is named. The Neuhauser Lecture is one of the signature events here at the Fairbanks Center. It has been for some 25 years. We have two major lectures a year. This is the main lecture in the fall. We have another named lecture, the Reischauer Lectures, which happen in the spring. That's our tradition. It's one of our rites, one of our annual ceremonies. It's a time when we all come together from all the different walks of Chinese studies, from whence we originate. I myself am a historian, but we have many here today in literature, in politics, in government, in law, all sorts of fields, sociology, and so on. So this is a really valuable opportunity. There's so much to going on here, it's rare that we actually get to come together as a single community. And it's especially nice because it's a time for many members of the broader Fairbanks studies, Fairbanks Center community, the Chinese studies community largely in the Boston and New England area to gather as a group. And as I'm looking around, I see many familiar faces, people who are standing who shouldn't be standing, wouldn't normally be standing, and also many new faces as well. So this lecture is given in honor of Charlie Neuhauser. He was known all his life, I'm told. I did not know him myself personally, but I'm told he always went by Charlie. This on the authority of his brother Paul, who is, he and his wife Mary are the generous sponsors of this event. And in fact, on that note, I'd like to take a moment to say thank you and to ask for a round of applause to thank the Neuhausers for making this all possible. So Charlie Neuhauser was a graduate of the Harvard class of 53. He was a longtime public servant, and he was what in the old days they used to call a China hand. He also had very close ties to the Fairbanks Center back before it was known as the Fairbanks Center. John Fairbank was here. At that time it was called the Center for East Asian Research. We are told that, and here I'm quoting, Charlie was a man of strong opinions and acerbic wit, which I think means that he fit in very, very well here at Harvard, and certainly I think he must have gotten along very well with John Fairbank, who was also a man of strong opinions and very dry wit. Sadly, Charlie died very young. He died in 1987. And very soon afterwards, as I mentioned, his brother Paul generously established this lecture series in his memory. Paul himself, class of 1955. The first of these lectures occurred in 1989, and they have taken place pretty much every year since then. Every year, we invite a public intellectual to present thoughts on Chinese politics, on foreign policy, on U.S.-China relations, or just general thoughts on China watching, which these days in particular repays our time and attention richly with all sorts of unexpected things showing up in the news pretty much every week. It's never a dull moment. And all of this is in memory of the way that Charlie Neuhauser managed so well to bridge the world between academia and public service and to connect China scholars with policymakers and members of the intelligence community. I'd like to take a moment here and call on my colleague, Professor Rod McFarquhar of the Government Department, who, of course, is well known to, I think, everybody in this room, but who knew Charlie personally. I've asked Rod to share a memory or two with us here before we get on to the business at hand about Mr. Neuhauser. Rod, can we impose on you for a moment?
If you want to know roughly what Charlie would have looked like today, look at his brother. There's a very strong family resemblance. And his wife is nodding, so he can't get out of it. Charlie was a CIA agent. He was an analyst, not someone who went bang, bang abroad. And I think he started on the Soviet side and then moved over to China, which became increasingly more interesting. And of course, there was the Sino-Soviet dispute in the 60s, which he was looking at. And he also did some work on the early part of the Cultural Revolution, published an article in the China Quarterly on it. Charlie was, on the one hand, he was very much a CIA person. If only I could tell you. A lot of that, a wry smile. But in fact, he did believe strongly, and that's why this lecture series is so important, he did believe strongly in the interaction of government servants with the academics. And the reason he was up here was because Fairbank had a policy at that time of having a CIA person or a State Department person up for a year as a means of bridging that gap. And Charlie was not merely a CIA agent, he was a liberal CIA agent. And this most strongly I remember being exemplified by the fact that the Association of Asian Studies held a meeting in the Boston area while he was up that year. And I remember Owen Lattimore was one of the speakers. And Owen Lattimore, of course, anathema to the right wing in this country. And Charlie was seen clapping vigorously. And I went up to him afterwards and I said, Charlie, you were clapping so vigorously. He said, yes, I wanted to show that some of us in the CIA are not right conservatives. And so we forgave him a lot. There was sometimes quite a bit to forgive, but we forgave him a lot because he was a good man. He worked earnestly on China and on Russia as well. And we miss him a great deal. And we owe a great debt to Paul, of course, for the financial underpinning of this lecture series, but also to the late Mike Oxenberg, who dreamt this whole idea for this lectureship up with Paul. Thank you.
I didn't know about Mike Oxenberg's involvement with that, so I learned something here too. Now, the first of these lectures was given by Richard Holbrooke, and Mike Oxenberg himself was another speaker in the series. It's been a very long and illustrious list. Douglas Powell, Stapleton Roy, Richard Solomon, Susan Shirk, James Lilly, David Shambaugh. Last year, as a number of you will remember, the speaker was Carl Eikenberry, who gave a very fine address, set a very high bar for any future Neuhauser speaker. However, our guest this year, the Honorable, and that's Honorable with a U, Kevin Rudd, is someone with years of practice at holding large audiences captive. And so I think we have another treat in store for us today. As everybody knows here, Kevin Rudd was the 26th Prime Minister of Australia from 2007 to 2010, and again in 2013. He was also Foreign Minister for Australia between 2010 and 2012. He has a very, very long Wikipedia entry, which I'm not going to recite for you. He is presently a senior fellow at the Belfer Center over at the Kennedy School. Before he became a politician, he was a diplomat for many years, which is true, he's a Queenslander, which connotes certain specific things in Australia, from educated in, he grew up in Brisbane, is that right?
The country.
in the country. He began as a diplomat, worked for many years in the diplomatic corps, but as with many of us, one of the most fateful choices he made was when he was still in university and he decided to take up the study of China and Chinese. And that was at the Australian National University, where he studied with the late, great Pierre Ryckmans, also known as Simon Lays. There's a lot of talk about politicians out there who speak Chinese, who know China. I've met a few of them. The only one I've met who really fits that bill is Kevin Rudd. Last year, we were showing him around the Harvard Yenching Library. He was very interested to see the Harvard Yenching Library, which itself, for a former prime minister, I think, is a sign of unusual sagacity and wisdom. We were walking around. We met one of our librarians, Sharon Yang. He began conversation with Sharon in perfect Mandarin. Sharon was very pleased, of course, nice conversation. And at the end, of course, he asked Sharon for her vote, which she promised to deliver at the next time that Kevin decides to stand for leadership of the Labor Party. We'll keep on waiting for that one. As head of government in Australia, there are many, many accomplishments here. One that I think I would like to single out is the institution of what is popularly known as Sorry Day in Australia in 2008, in which on behalf of the government and all former governments, Mr. Rudd issued a formal apology for past policies of Australian governments toward Indigenous peoples, particularly those of the Stolen Generation. This was an act of, I think, my opinion, great statesmanship. For us in Chinese studies, however, another important accomplishment of the Rudd administration was the decision to found the Australian Center for China in the World at the Australian National University with a very, very generous gift. That building, beautiful building, has just opened last May. Under the direction of Jeremy Barmay. We've had regular visits from Jeremy and from Richard Rigby and others associated with that center. This to me again shows a real kind of vision of the importance of scholarship, particularly scholarship on China, but also in other areas of the world, at a time when in our country we see funding being cut all the time. Funding cut from Fulbright fellowships, funding cut for FLAS fellowships, funding cut for the National Resource Center funding that Harvard has enjoyed for many years. Things are going down here in Australia. Thanks to Kevin Rudd, the future for Chinese studies looks very bright. The title of his talk for us today is An Alternate Future for U.S.-Chinese Relations. Please join me in giving a very warm welcome to Kevin Rudd.
Well, thank you very much for that very warm Harvard welcome. And it is an honor to be here at Harvard. It's an honor to be here at the Fairbanks Center. And it's an honor to be delivering this Neuhauser lecture. I always, on these occasions, feel somewhat anxious sitting before my vastly superior professorial betters. Professor Rod McFarquhar, who I read as a kid at university, Professor Ezra Vogel, who I read as a kid at university, and when I look at my colleague here, Professor Mark Elliott, one of the foremost scholars of the Qing, when I see my compatriots here also, Ross Terrell from Australia, also a formidable specialist on matters Chinese, and my other Australian compatriot here this evening, Father Frank Brennan, who is here and work with me on the National Apology to Indigenous Australians, and now lecturing in law as a visiting professor at Boston College. And it is good to be here with all of you, because this wide family around the world of those of us who take the study of China seriously is at one hand tight-knit, at another always fractious, and at another, always fascinated by this extraordinary phenomenon we describe the civilization that is China and its contemporary form in the People's Republic of China. Of course, this study has been taken seriously for not just generations, but now centuries, across what we might call the collective West. But now we find ourselves at this extraordinary point in history where those of us who have taken this study seriously over some years now find that that which we study is no longer just of academic interest, it is no longer of narrow policy interest, it is in fact of essential, vital national interests across the broader world. And so it was with great foresight that our friends, the Neuhauser family, decided to fund this lecture series over the years, and having listened to the august series of names of those who delivered it, it has been one well supported by people who know the field but are also engaged in the field of public policy. Is a common future for US-China relations possible? Or is some form of long-term conflict between the two inevitable? This, I believe, is the central question of our time. In seeking to identify an answer to this question, this week I have just returned from my 10th visit to Beijing this year alone, and last week from my 5th to Washington, all focused on this single core question, namely, is there sufficient commonality of values, interests, and capabilities between these two great countries despite their vastly different civilizational and ideational traditions, to craft a common future together? Or are we faced once again with the bleak, repetitive refrains from history, which caution us that it is much more probable that rising powers will inevitably confront established powers, or in reverse, in pursuit of the elusive status of great power supremacy, and therefore that China and the United States will constitute no such exception to the rule? I believe this to be the central question of our time because, whether we are conscious of it or not, the future shape of the current regional and global orders, politically, economically, diplomatically, militarily, environmentally, societally, and legally, will be determined by the resolution of this question one way or the other. And that is why I have come to the Harvard Kennedy School's Belfer Center this year to look at this question through the eyes of a third party, as someone with a long-standing professional and personal engagement both in Beijing and in Washington, as well as somebody who has a deep abiding affection for different reasons for both these countries. Yet as I come towards the conclusion of this project, I find my natural optimism is being deeply challenged by the new, changing dynamics of the US-China relationship. It is not that there is no rational way through the structural and immediate challenges facing the US-China relationship. Of course, I believe there is. It is because there seems to be little political way through, if we can accept the common definition that politics is indeed the art of the possible. And further, I fear that the political window may be beginning to close, particularly in Beijing. My argument in this lecture is as follows. First, that the core gap in US-China relations is a gap in political values, which cannot readily be breached. Second, that the strategic perceptions that each political elite has of each other is increasingly negative. And third, that the common interest that both systems share at this stage is insufficient to create enough strategic, diplomatic, and political ballast to fundamentally alter the inherently competitive and in time, perhaps conflictual nature of the relationship. Fourth, that the inherent dynamics of the relationship are likely to create an increasing sense and in time reality of strategic drift, which can only be arrested if the leadership of the two countries consciously and deliberately embark on a common strategic narrative for a common rather than a divided future. And finally, that such a shared narrative for the long-term future of the relationship must simultaneously be realist about what fundamental differences exist and cannot for the foreseeable future be overcome, constructive about where common agreement can be reached and where common institutions can be built. And thirdly, committed also to building strategic trust step by step, with the possibility that this can gradually transform this otherwise competitive and potentially conflictual relationship over time. While recognizing all along that this latter possibility, this positive possibility, represents a hard challenge for the political leadership of both countries, when most but not all of the natural counterforces at the elite levels of this relationship seem to be working in precisely the reverse direction. I argue that absent such a common narrative, and one both conceptualized and driven at the highest political level, I fear where strategic drift will take us, as drift turns into a current, which over time becomes almost irresistible. And so my deepest fear is that because of our many seeming more pressing domestic and foreign policy preoccupations, we, by which I mean both the United States and China, may miss the historical tipping point during a time when the capabilities gap between the two countries begins to close, and when there is still sufficient political space for statesmen to make different strategic choices for the future. Chinese and American values. It is perhaps the understatement of our time to state that Chinese and American political values are different. Different in their content, different in the scope of their desired application, and different in the passion of their exposition. Here in the United States and across the wider West, we are deeply familiar with the liberal democratic values that constitute the lodestone on which our contemporary political institutions are constructed. We are also familiar with the fact that across the cumulative and collective history of what we loosely call the West, this has been a relatively recent phenomenon. Prior to the American and French revolutions, which occurred at the approximate midpoint of China's last dynasty, the Qing, and during the long reign of the Emperor Qianlong, the political history of Europe prior to that was largely monarchical, authoritarian, and in some cases absolute, with limited roles for parliaments, which were in turn elected by limited franchises. For the American Republic and for its birth, beginning in this great city, Boston, all this changed fundamentally, as the city on the hill, built on the dual foundations of political and religious freedom, became the leitmotif of the American example to the world. The early republic did not seek to propagate its message to the world, but rather to be a moral exemplar to the world, drawing the peoples of the old world to the shores of the new to share the fruits of the American Revolution. It was not until after the Second World War, where America became a decisive factor in the defeat of fascism in both Europe and the Pacific, that the active global propagation of American values became an inextricable part of what came to be known as American exceptionalism across the world at large. During the unfolding Cold War with the Soviet Union, in which Washington embarked upon a policy of containment against Moscow, reinforced by a deliberate ideological confrontation between the competing value systems of liberal democracy on the one hand and Marxist-Leninism on the other, the universalism of American values continued to gain pace. With the collapse of the Soviet Union, there may have been some abatement of American enthusiasm for the global evangelization of the liberal democratic project, but the project itself continues nonetheless and has become, in my observation, an indelible part of the American global political identity. This tradition, this American tradition, stands in contrast to that of classical and contemporary China. I argue that it does so in two respects. First, the value system of classical Confucianism and the Marxist-Leninism of the current period, albeit with Chinese characteristics, 中国特色的社会主义, is fundamentally hierarchical in nature. There is little evidence, readily identifiable, as political liberalism in either the ancient or modern Chinese political tradition. In this continuing Chinese political tradition, the individual is not in possession of inalienable human rights. Rather, what rights do exist in the Chinese political tradition are those bestowed on the individual by the emperor, or more recently the state, but always made conditional on the appropriate exercise of reciprocal responsibilities from that same individual. Second, whereas the American liberal democratic system was determined by the founding fathers of the Republic as universal rather than particular to any culture, Chinese Confucianism was traditionally seen by the Chinese as applying to the Middle Kingdom alone. The Chinese view was that foreigners were from time to time welcome to come to China to observe, to understand, and indeed imbibe the inherent virtue and virtues of the Chinese philosophical system. Yet the Chinese had no particular interest in either actively evangelizing its tradition to the rest of the world, let alone seeking to impose it either ideologically, politically, or militarily. The third difference between the two traditions grows naturally from the second, namely the degree of passion attached to the globalization of the liberal democratic cause, as opposed to the relative indifference of successive generations of Chinese emperors on the question, this question of active propagation beyond China's borders. Of course, after 1949, Chinese communism did, through various ebbs and flows, go through a period of seeking to export the Chinese revolution around the world, which the Maoists in Nepal and the Shining Path guerrillas in Peru continue as isolated and somewhat embarrassing legacies from this limited period of universalist ideological zeal. All this, however, came to an abrupt halt after Deng Xiaoping's return to politics 35 years ago, when the Chinese variant of communist internationalism was quietly, but nonetheless decisively, confined to history. Which, of course, brings us to the present. Over the subsequent 35 years, China has actively sought to appropriate the capitalist dimension of the liberal capitalist project, culminating in the 2013 party plenum's decision to place the market as the central principle of the Chinese economic development model. But while Marxism is now officially dead, the Leninist structure of the original Marxist-Leninist state has been retained, with a continued concentration of political power in that of a one-party state. Importantly, China has also in recent years moved from a passive defensive posture against the claimed universalism of the democratic liberalist ideal of the West to an ideological posture of now routinely attacking the failures of the liberal democratic model and increasingly proactive advocacy of the China model to the developing world in particular. In particular, the Chinese official media now highlights the dysfunctionality of Western and Indian democratic models as incapable of concentrating the political resolve of states on the core continuing task of economic development. Whether it's gridlock on Capitol Hill, the political and economic inertia of Western Europe, or the failure of the Indian political system to build a modern infrastructure system to underpin its development, the Chinese critique targeted both domestic and foreign audiences is becoming louder and louder. A core question for the future of US-China relations, however, is the extent to which this fundamental values divide renders any real broader cooperation between Washington and Beijing ultimately futile. Specifically, a core question from the American perspective is whether or not China, because of its successful economic development program, will ultimately transition and therefore become an active supporter and participant in the international liberal rules-based order. Or alternatively, whether China will succeed in defying history and produce a politically and economically sustainable model for China's own long-term future without succumbing to liberalism in its many forms, either at home or in its engagement abroad. The answer to these questions lies in the internal deliberations of the Chinese government, because international pressure, however executed and however well-intentioned, is unlikely to succeed in bringing about liberal democratic reforms domestically within China. In fact, such pressures arguably produce the reverse effect. For China, the related core question is whether the United States fundamentally accepts the legitimacy of China's current political system, or whether China concludes that the United States is directly or indirectly working to subvert that system. While this may appear to be an unsubstantiated and somewhat paranoid proposition to US and Western analysts, the same analysts may be surprised to learn how profoundly this question of perceived political legitimacy fundamentally drive so many of the dynamics of the overall US-China relationship. From a Chinese perspective, US challenges to the ultimate legitimacy of China's one-party state, either stated or unstated, are foundational to Chinese conclusions about whether the US is in fact engaged in a range of programs and actions aimed at delegitimizing the Chinese Communist Party, internally dividing the party and then dividing the country with a view to bringing about fundamental change in China's political regime. From a US perspective, this may seem utterly counterintuitive, as from the outside, they see a formidable Chinese state, a formidable security and intelligence apparatus, and a party confident of its political and economic future. From the inside, the picture looks somewhat different, as the party focuses on the multiplicity of domestic challenges it faces, any one of which could go radically wrong, including the effective management of the internal security of 1.3 billion people. So a central and sensitive, yet little discussed question for the future of the US-China relationship is this: is there any possible landing point between the different value systems of the two countries capable of being better addressed in any future reformulation of the doctrinal fundamentals of the US-China relationship? Or at least to the extent that it of itself does not derail further substantive areas of operational cooperation between the two countries. In addition to debates about differing core values, another central organizing principle for the future of the US-China relationship lies in current strategic perceptions or misperceptions of one another. Or as one seasoned diplomatic practitioner at work within the US-China relationship recently observed to me privately, the US-China relationship is governed by a principle of what can best be called mutually assured misperception. Strategic perceptions are, of course, notoriously difficult to decipher and to define. Perceptions, nonetheless, accurate or otherwise, fundamentally shape international behavior. They embrace a vast array of subjective observations and conclusions about the other party, assuming, of course, that the first party is inherently objective. They incorporate the complex domain of diplomatic signaling. They also embrace many of the assumptions contained within the vast social science and occasional hard science literature on game theory. Specifically, strategic perception embraces one party's calculations of the capabilities of another, a calculation of the intentionalities of another, calculations as to how most effectively to communicate a foreign or security policy message in relation to the other party, as well as assumptions as to how the other party will most likely respond to given messages on the part of the originating party, as well as further assumptions as to how additional sequences of action and reaction are likely to unfold. In other words, it's pretty simple. There have been many reports in recent times concerning deep Chinese perceptions of what constitutes the substantive elements of US strategy towards China. They have been reflected, most recently, in an unpublished five-point formulation, which reportedly concludes that US strategy towards China now seeks to 1. Divide China, 2. Contain China, 3. Isolate China, 4. Diminish China, and 5. Ultimately sabotage the Chinese leadership. Some may contest the accuracy of this standardized five-point formulation. Nonetheless, few analysts can dispute the fact that in recent years, each of these individual claims have been leveled against the United States and others in the collective West in various Chinese official media at various times. The point is this: if these conclusions are in fact genuinely held by core elements of the Chinese leadership, this is not of just passing academic interest. If genuinely held, they represent significant conclusions about the long-term trajectory of the relationship, which, at least superficially, are conflictual and therefore deeply disturbing. So what is to be made of each of these five contentions? On dividing China, the argument goes that the US, by various overt and covert means, directly and indirectly, is actively seeking to foment internal discord and political separatism within the People's Republic. Accusations are made concerning US-funded NGOs supporting separatist movements both in Xinjiang and in Tibet. Accusations are also made concerning US attitude to the Dalai Lama, particularly in that by embracing the Dalai in various meetings with US presidents, the US is inherently legitimizing Tibetan separatism. To this is added the more recent accusations that the US and the UK are at present actively fomenting street protests in Hong Kong, which, so the accusation goes, are designed at preventing the final and effective reunification of Hong Kong with the People's Republic. And to this already formidable list is added the long-standing problem of US arms sales to Taiwan, in addition to the continuing opaque security assurances provided to Taiwan by the United States in the event of China resorting to military means, ultimately to reunite the motherland by force of arms. Furthermore, and as a natural expression of the differing traditions of the Chinese and American value systems, which I've referred to above, there are further accusations the United States, through its funding of a broad network of NGOs, is actively pushing the fragmentation of Communist Party rule by supporting the expansion of Christianity in China and extending the role of NGOs from environmental causes to labor rights, as well as the generally seditious effect of Western values on Chinese youth through a potent cocktail of social media, Western movies and entertainment, and the influence of Western universities on Chinese students returning from America and elsewhere in the collective West. Within the Chinese government, which actively seeks to retain the traditional role of the Chinese Communist Party for the future, this collectivity of perceptions is slowly taking hold, I argue, among political elites, arguing that the US, by these various means, is seeking to weaken and ultimately divide the country. This in turn is predicated on the Chinese assumption, and this is a core point, that the US will never willingly countenance the possibility of surrendering its dominant standing in the global order voluntarily to China. This is reinforced in the Chinese calculations by applying a high-level dose of hyper-realism, as well as perhaps on China's part an equally high degree of strategic mirror imaging, that the US will inevitably resort to other measures to stop or impede China's rise, because after all, that is what China would do if it found itself in America's shoes. As for the charge that the US is diminishing, isolating, and containing China, Chinese official commentaries have for decades pointed to the continuation of the US alliance structure in Asia. China argues that these military alliances are relics from the Cold War, and that in the absence of a further Cold War, they have no legitimacy or relevance other than to contain China. The Chinese further argue against legitimacy of the pivot or rebalance of 3 years ago, which they have concluded reinforces their conclusions concerning the content of US containment strategy. And this argument is trebly reinforced from the Chinese perspective by the strengthening of various of these alliances, for example, with Japan, with Singapore, and Australia. Finally, these originally bilateral security arrangements with the United States and its allies have been compounded further in Chinese eyes by the rapid development of trans-alliance defense exercises, intelligence sharing, and strategic planning, which again are seen as almost exclusively targeted against China. These Chinese perceptions are further reinforced by China's own sense of strategic vulnerability at multiple levels, including a long-standing land border dispute with India, including the particular political status of the Dalai Lama and Dharamsala, the largest number of any other country in the world except Russia of shared boundaries with other states, outstanding maritime disputes with all of its maritime neighbors, as well as the growing external Chinese energy dependency, including the uncertain political military theaters in the world, such as the Gulf, through which so much of China's oil imports pass, and a deep sense of strategic vulnerability also in the event of any wider conflict concerning the Straits of Malacca. More broadly, China sees itself now in wider East Asia and the West Pacific as being strategically isolated, without any natural friends or allies in the wider region, and instead penned in by a number of its neighboring states, a number of which are allies of the United States. China, therefore, from time to time expresses a desire to break out of the strategic straitjacket in which it believes both history and nature, and most recently American policy, have constrained it. As for American strategic perceptions of China, these fall into broader perceptions of a more assertive Chinese foreign policy in most diplomatic fora around the world. New forms of assertive military behavior in the East and South China Seas, together with the relatively rapid increases in Chinese defense expenditure. The American perception is that China, certainly within the region, is no longer a status quo power. They believe that China is seeking to expand its natural sphere of influence, and that it is seeking to do so through a strategy of economically overwhelming the region, rather than bringing on any premature military conflict. Furthermore, Americans reject Chinese contentions concerning containment. They argue that the US encouraged, facilitated, and embraced China's engagement with the global economy over the last 25 years, and this in turn has been the basis of China's rise to great power status economically. By contrast, containment in US foreign and security policy practice meant isolating and ultimately strangling the Soviet economy. Moreover, the US has not only refused to follow China's rapid increase in investment in the military, so they argue, in recent decades, but in fact has begun a process of retrenchment in order to address the overarching fiscal impacts on its government. Americans also ask a core strategic question about Beijing when they ask directly, what is China currently being contained from doing as a consequence of US policy, which China would otherwise want to do? In other words, the American view, as I've ascertained it, is that if the US was seriously in the business of containing China, both China and the rest of the world would really know about it. Americans have also identified what they regard as the beginning of a global push by China to either significantly reshape existing global institutions to better suit Chinese interests, or to begin to grow new global institutions of its own, the most recent example of which is China's proposal for a regional infrastructure bank in Asia. So is there a path we can find ourselves to navigate between these conflicting strategic perceptions, where China concludes that it is being strategically isolated by its neighbors and contained by the United States, whereas the United States concludes that it is China that is seeking to change the regional status quo, without explaining in the American argument what China's strategic objectives in doing so might be? Once again, this plays directly into the present and prospective state of the US-China relationship. Not only is the values divide between the two significant, so too is the current perceptions divide between the two most significant, which in turn leads to the question of how any further formulation on the relationship's future could manage, reduce, if not eliminate, the perceptions divide between the two. These deep divides between Chinese and American values and perceptions are reinforced further by the differences between the two sides of assessments of each other's long-term intentionalities, one toward the other. The Chinese argue that they have long committed to a strategic policy direction called peaceful development. And that is true, hoping fajan. And on this, it is worthwhile reflecting for a moment that if China were to have embarked upon a fundamentally contrary policy, we too would know about it, and the evidence would be everywhere to see, but it is nowhere to be seen. China also argues that within this framework, their primary concern for the foreseeable future is the transformation of the current Chinese economic growth model. This is a task of enormous complexity in itself, and one, if it is to be successful, will require continued regional and global peace and stability. The Chinese further argue that the implementation of their new growth model, including a rapid adjustment to sustainable development models, rather than perpetuating the environmentally destructive growth models of the past, reflects the overriding importance of China's domestic policy agenda. Once China's long-term strategic intentions of Chinese national wealth and power have been achieved, China has indicated that it will play a more active role in the global order, as well as what it describes as the reform of the order over time, to better reflect the realities of a more multipolar distribution of power in the future. Regionally, China has indicated that it intends to pursue a more proactive role in order to make the region, in particular its neighboring states, more conducive to China's foreign policy interests. When it comes to the United States, China's public formulation is that on the one hand, China welcomes America's long-term strategic presence in the region, but on the other, China continues to attack the continued US alliance structure and seeks to pry certain American allies away from their long-term security arrangements with the United States. Finally, as noted above, China deeply believes the United States would not readily yield its current position of global preeminence. Therefore, China in the long term anticipates deep and continuing strategic competition between the two, as well as the deployment, in its view, of US political, economic, diplomatic, and possible military power where necessary to preserve the current global status of the United States as the global number one. What of American perceptions of long-term Chinese intentionalities? The US, by contrast, has little public narrative on long-term Chinese strategic intentionality, although privately it is deeply skeptical of the benign nature of China's declaratory positions. The US views current Chinese policies in the East and South China Seas as unilaterally seeking to alter the status quo, as well as inferring a predisposition towards the deployment of force if necessary. I argue that there are problems with this particular US perception, particularly given Chinese arguments that Chinese maritime actions, both in relation to Japan and in Southeast Asia, have been in response to actions by other governments who themselves unilaterally changed the status quo in these contested maritime zones. The US, I argue, also has a view of China's operational strategy across Asia, as I noted before, to economically overwhelm its immediate neighbors and then in turn the wider region. Such a strategy, it is argued, China would in time render itself so economically indispensable to each country in the region that it would render impossible, or at least improbable, long-term political resistance by regional governments to the growing expansion of a Chinese economic and foreign policy sphere of influence. So this particular American argument goes. Further, under this argument, it is further contended that the utility of such a long-term Chinese sphere of influence would be to constrain future foreign and security policy actions by regional governments, which would be judged by Beijing at that time to be in conflict with Chinese national interests. Americans also identify a parallel strategy of economically overwhelming other parts of the world as well. This argument points to China's emerging economic dominance in Africa, Latin America, Europe, and in time, the Middle East. In the case of Europe, this strategy of rendering China economically indispensable to countries in the EU is also specifically designed to soften and in time silence European human rights objections over Chinese policy and practice. So this argument goes. And against that objective, Americans point to the example of Chinese policy towards countries like Norway as a European example of what happens if a country to a country when it fundamentally crosses China's human rights policy and reputation, given China's action in freezing further economic engagement with Norway in response to Norway awarding the Nobel Peace Prize to a Chinese dissident. Finally, Americans also argue that whereas China for the foreseeable future will seek to advance its strategic influence primarily by economic means, at the same time, China will continue its military modernization program over the decades ahead. Americans readily acknowledge the vast gap that continues to exist between the two sides in practically all categories of military capability, including those which apply to most scenarios in the Western Pacific, where any conflict in the future with China would most likely arise first. Nonetheless, American analysts point to the long-term narrowing in the overall military capabilities gap. and they see China's overall strategic intention to be one of economic and strategic dominance over the US in East Asia through China's combined economic, in the present, and military in the future advance over time. In the meantime, however, Americans calculate China because it will not wish to take on the profound risk of premature military confrontation with the US or its principal allies. China, under these circumstances, would do everything possible to avoid such confrontation unless and until China calculates its overall correlation of forces against the United States is decisively in China's favor in the East Asian hemisphere. For these reasons, there is potentially fundamentally divergent long-term thinking, both in Beijing and Washington, about where the other's long-term strategic intentionalities ultimately lie. This long-term divergence also reinforces the differences I have identified above in terms of more immediate political, diplomatic, and military perceptions of one another's behavior, as well as the underlying differences in the values inherent in Chinese and American worldviews, which are of course anchored in their vastly different civilizational origins. For these reasons, whatever common interests we may be able to identify between China and the United States, and they occur and exist across a vast range indeed, these will nonetheless be located within this wider framework of conflicting values, perceptions, and intentionalities that are in danger of becoming, I fear, embedded in parts of the elite-level relationship. Therefore, the core challenge of finding a common narrative for a common future to be shared between the United States and China as a substantive exercise rather than just a paper exercise is increasingly fraught with complexity. While at the same time, the need for such a shared long-term narrative, in my argument, becomes one of greater and greater urgency and necessity. To conclude, these remarks have primarily concentrated on China and America as seen through each other's eyes, in terms of their values, their current strategic perceptions of each other, as well as their conclusions concerning long-term strategic intentionality in East Asia. And I have done so describing the perceptions of political, national security, and foreign policy elites, without reference to what people in people-to-people contexts may think about one another across the Pacific between China and the United States, which is, in my view, a vastly different domain. I recently presented a more detailed version of China's strategic perceptions of the US at the CSIS in Washington, D.C., at the beginning of this month. I did the reverse at the Institute of International Studies at Fudan University in Shanghai last week, on that occasion concentrating on American strategic perceptions of China. I've sought to do the same in each capital, though Shanghai is not a capital, except if you happen to be Shanghainese, in which case it is. Tonight, I seek to bring these analyses together in the hope that by doing so, we can shed light on that which may really divide the two countries on the one hand, irrespective of whether such differences are real, contrived, or misconceived. As I said at the outset of my remarks, differences in values and in perceptions and understandings of long-term intentionalities do fundamentally shape the conceptual and operational dimensions of the US-China relationship. And the more powerful China becomes, the sharper these differences in perceptions, I fear, are likely to become. So let me now conclude in similar terms to those I use both in Washington and in Shanghai. In foreign policy, the beginning of wisdom is to understand what the other party thinks, what they believe, and why they believe it. And this is just as important for our Chinese friends as it is for our friends in the United States. Nonetheless, I am not some sort of foreign policy utopian, believing that there is some mystical center point which will bring both of these worldviews into one day mysteriously coinciding, like one huge metaphysical Zhongyong. I'm too much of a realist for that. Although at the same time, I am sufficient of a liberal internationalist not to allow hyper-realism to overwhelm the possibilities of evolving a common approach for both the US and China, at least dealing with some common challenges for the future. As I've written for most of this year that I have been at the Harvard Kennedy School. I believe what is useful is for the two presidents, President Xi Jinping and President Obama, to develop a common narrative between them for the future that allows sufficient space for real differences to be acknowledged. At present, each side has a narrative, usually private rather than public, about what the other is really up to. Instead, I argue for a narrative that is public, that contains an overall framework, a mechanism for managing differences, as well as a longer-term goal of substantive positive improvement in these areas of fundamental disagreement. One possible framework might be called constructive realism, or even constructive realism for a common future. What do I mean by that? First, the realist part. Both the Chinese and the Americans come from deeply realist approaches to international relations. And within that framework, there are defined areas where a lack of common values or a lack of common interests deny any ready or immediate resolution. Areas such as the outstanding territorial disputes in East Asia involving American allies and Chinese claims of sovereignty. These cannot be solved for the foreseeable future. They can only be acknowledged and, importantly, managed, so the conflict does not erupt, thereby destroying the relationship altogether. Second, if that's the realist part, what's the constructive part? Namely, those areas of the relationship, bilateral, regional, or multilateral, where China and the US, because of sufficient overlapping values and interests, can cooperate to build new public goods together. Bilaterally, in areas such as the Bilateral Investment Treaty, new approaches to regional architecture in the Asia Pacific that help construct some basic confidence and security building measures over time in a region where at present there are none. Globally, climate change, cybersecurity, as well as dealing with the new challenges of militant Islamism, which now spread in an arc from the west of Africa across the Middle East through Central Asia and further to the east again. Then, of course, there is the opportunity for China and the United States to work on a very large-scale common strategic challenge indeed, and that is the future removal of the nuclear threat on the Korean Peninsula, in addition to how to manage the peaceful reunification of the peninsula as well. That's the constructive bit. So, third, what's the future bit? Well, if strategic trust is built incrementally over time by achieving success in the constructive part of the relationship I've described above, to deploy then the political and diplomatic and strategic capital from these successes to tackling the thus far too difficult to solve issues in the realist part of the relationship. It is important, I believe, to have a long-term ambition for the future of the relationship. Otherwise, it will simply be seen as an exercise in temporary utilitarianism. And otherwise, we are simply postponing the inevitability of crisis or conflict, or even, God forbid, war. Of itself, such a long-term ambition, that is, a common future together, where we can not just develop accumulated political capital from cooperating and constructing new bilateral, regional, and global public goods, but managing continuing realist challenges which at present defy common solution. If we do have a common vision for a common future, one crafted through political leadership, then in fact this can be transformative over time. Of course, such a concept of constructive realism, with or without a common future, would provide a framework for gradual progress and ideally less regress over time. The good news is that I believe these concepts may well translate reasonably into Chinese. Realism is as sound a word in Chinese as it is in English. Xianshizhuyi. Nothing wrong with Xianshizhuyi if you come from China. Constructive is an overwhelming positive phrase in Chinese. Jianshi. Jianshixing. If I know anything about my Chinese friends and those in the People's Republic, they are permanently constructing, or jianshi, a whole bunch of things. Everything from a local building to your civilizational Jingshan Wuran, Zhengzai Jianshe. So, not Jingshan Wuran, Jingshan Wenming. And so, constructive, therefore, is a term which translates well into Chinese. And it's difficult but not impossible to reject the idea of a long-term common future in either language, albeit through a process of gradual transformation or 渐渐改变. Finally, who should be our helmsman in this process? Well, none other than Deng Xiaoping. He even had a phrase that, while traditionally used to describe the arduous task of Chinese domestic economic reform, I believe it may be more broadly applicable as well. Deng Xiaoping, who I regard to be one of the great figures of the 20th century, and some might argue the greatest figure of the 20th century, said that to cross the river, it is important to feel the stone step by step with your feet. So too might we be able to breach the widening gap between China and the United States over time. It requires a realistic understanding, however, of the values and the perceptions of the interests of the other. You cannot proclaim mutual strategic trust overnight, as if it will commence here, Harvard time, at 9 a.m. tomorrow morning, that the United States and China will begin trusting each other. That is hushuobadao. It requires, however, a construct. It requires an intellectual framework. It requires a long-term foreign policy framework within which the diversity of these challenges, both realist and constructive and building a long-term future, can be accommodated internally. Otherwise, the habits of diplomats and leaders is to focus either exclusively on an area of cooperation or exclusively and overwhelmingly on an area of real strategic difficulty, to the exclusion of the other dimensions of the relationship. This will require an equal amount of creative diplomatic imagination about what can be done constructively together. It will also require the political will to dream of a different future other than that which history has shown us so often horrifically from the past. Perhaps this is what Xi Jinping had in mind when he floated a new type of great power relationship, 一种新型大国关系. President Xi has talked much about the China dream, 中国梦. In this country, the American dream is embedded within the culture, 美国梦. It's part and parcel of what America is, part and parcel of its identity. Maybe, however, it's time for us all to start dreaming more broadly of a common dream for all our futures, 共同梦. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We will be taking questions. I'm going to say two or three things first. One is that there is a reception following today's talk, following the Q&A. It's in the Lee Gathering Room, which, as you exit this room, is on your left. We have refreshments there, to which everybody here is most cordially welcome, and we can continue the conversation that will begin momentarily out there. I also want to say a special thanks to the staff at the Fairbanks Center, which has worked valiantly to bring this event off. As you see, it's an event of some scale, they have really done a magnificent job, and so my personal gratitude to them. In terms of questions, I would ask, in order that as many people as possible may have the opportunity to ask Mr. Rudd questions, that you keep your remarks brief and to the point, and that there be a question mark at the end of your question. I want to say, just to get things started, that in, you know, when we talk about, or when I think about foreign policy, when one hears discussions about it, it's very often put on a very abstract level, and it's often easy to forget that in matters of foreign affairs, that real individual people play a very important part. I think that Kevin Rudd is in a very important place right now, actually, in U.S.-China relations. He's a politician who has been in the thick of it. He is a veteran of the diplomatic corps, so he understands how the diplomatic service works and what's possible and what's not possible. He has both of those sides of the career. He is also, as we have heard now, extremely well versed in not just the Chinese language, but in all different aspects of Chinese history and politics. So he is somebody with an unusual level of credibility, I would suggest, on both sides of the equation here, and has decided to use this position to try to advance a dialogue, to help put in place, to help conceive of and put in place a framework whereby the parties in both the United States and in China can work toward a more stable and brighter future, as we have heard. And he has brought this dialogue to us here at Harvard in the spirit that I think is very much in keeping with the spirit that animated this place back in the 50s and the 60s and in the decades since then, when these sorts of questions were never far from people's minds. I'm very grateful to him for taking this this role on, this position on. It's an enormous amount of travel. You said 10 trips to Beijing and 5 to Washington, and we don't even know the other places that you have been in the meantime.
Boston,
not often enough. We want to see more of you.
Cambridge, I've been quite often. I just haven't been to Boston.
So that's my, I have, of course, other thoughts here, but I'm going to save those for now. It's your chance to pose some questions to our speaker, Kevin Rudd. See this hand first.
Mr. Rudd, thank you so much for coming and for your speech. My name is Mansoor. I'm a first year at the Harvard Business School. My question is, as to the values that you spoke to in the first part of your speech, do you believe those are immutable, or do you think that they have potential to evolve with wealth and development level, as perhaps they did in Korea, Taiwan, and other countries?
Well, of course, development economists will tell you that there is the magical $10,000 per capita income threshold, after which you will see the rolling expectations in societies of which have a culture for greater levels of political aspiration for the evolution of their own political futures. So the question here is whether China will constitute the great grand exception or not. I'm not in a position to predict. I've observed it with other Northeast Asian societies, Korea, Japan, and you've seen, of course, within the Sinosphere, what has evolved in Taiwan. So this is an open question. What I do know as an observer of China, and having first gone to live there 30 years ago, this year, in fact, this month, I haven't changed a bit. It was a joke, by the way. Thank you for laughing.
I haven't changed either.
What I describe as the China Freedom Index, that is, what level of freedoms does each Chinese person have now as to what they had 30 years ago? This is like traveling from Mars to Venus. I mean, this is just a huge change. I always say in lectures around the world, this was China when I went to live there, and this is kind of China now. In terms of your freedom to choose whether you go abroad to study, what you study at home, freedom to find your own job, freedom to get married by and large when you want to, freedom to read most things, not all things that you want. Now, there are still enormous limitations on those freedoms. I don't pretend that they don't exist, but I think we've got to recognize that through the process of economic reform and opening, Gaiguo Kaifang, that the living standards, but also the personal freedom of individual Chinese has changed significantly over that period of time for the better. But it is a brave man or woman indeed who makes a bold prediction about where this trajectory will take China into the future. And as someone who has looked at this for a long time, I am not prepared to make such a projection. Thank you.
Hello, thank you for your wonderful speech. I want to know what's the Australians' role in between the China-US relationship? Is it the same as when you are in power?
No, we just bring the beer so that this makes people a bit more cheerful. Otherwise, you guys just get too serious about it all. Our attitude is pretty simple. I mean, at our best, and we're not always at our best, we Australians, at our absolute best, we are the West in the East, and perhaps even the East in the West. And if you look at a country like Australia, we are required by our circumstances and our size to understand respectfully and intimately the cultures and civilizations of wider East Asia. We learnt all of that in 1941 when we figured that the British, by and large, were not all that smart and they really didn't understand the world and they certainly didn't understand Asia. And the resolve in 1945 by one of my Labour predecessors as Prime Minister of Australia, Ben Chifley, when he established the Australian National University and other centres around the country, that this was to equip the next generation of Australians with our own indigenous knowledge of what was unfolding, not just in China, but in Southeast Asia, in Indonesia, in India. And so began an Antipodean equivalent of the School of African Oriental Studies. And so it has evolved positively over the years, and I'm one of its products, for good or for ill. So I think that has, over generations, caused Australians to have a somewhat, shall I say, textured view of the civilizations of Asia, including China. Because of that, and we've looked at these things through national necessity and through the lens of our own proximity. For the United States, it's always been a bit different. And that is, the academy here has been, I think, outstanding on China. The previous speakers in this lecture series, there's a roll call of brilliant sinologists who have always seen China inherently significant. But that's not always been shared by your political elites. I think in Australia, because of where we are, proximity, and our experience in 41, when we just didn't get what was about to happen, that we have now a different set of perceptions. My final point in answer to your question is, look, I'm not here standing before you and saying that Australia is not an ally of the United States. We are. And I have been Prime Minister of a country and Foreign Minister of a country which is allied to the United States. I'm not going to pretend here to be perfectly objective. I can't. Anyone who claims perfect objectivity in any presentation is exercising a position of postmodernist or pre-modernist self-delusion. You cannot do that and be honest with your conscience and your soul. But what I have sought to do in my remarks today and the work I'm doing here more broadly in Harvard is as accurately as I can to describe what I believe to be the perceived realities, both from a Beijing perspective and, frankly, from Washington as well. Whether I happen to agree with those conclusions is a separate matter and, frankly, not all that important. My great disturbance, I find, in the Sino-US relationship conducted at elite levels, it is often couched in such a level of generality where, frankly, diplomaties has become a substitute for genuine discussion about real areas of hard difference, as well as what you can really do together, that it may take a few bumptious Antipodeans to roll along and say, this is what you're saying to me about what you think about them, how about it? And the reverse, because when I speak in China, I'm just as hard line about what I think American perceptions are. And the reverse in Washington the other day. The audience I spoke to in Washington the other day told me how shocked they were at hearing, quote, such a pro-Chinese statement. All I was doing was describing a Chinese perception of reality. Because unless we are clear about where those bottom line perceptions are and those which are legitimately held and those which can be shaped, in fact, by dialogue, because there is an element of misperception, then we're simply seeking to construct a long-term relationship based on a mirage. I'm all for a realist foundation. What have we got in common? What do we not have in common? How do you embrace that within a common conceptual framework for the relationship? And within that framework, build a common future. I don't know whether I'll succeed, but it's worth a year of my time to try.
Yeah. In the very back. You, sir.
Thanks. Hi, my name's Andrew Levitas. I'm a postdoctoral fellow at the Reischauer Institute at Harvard and an Australian, so it's great to have you here, Prime Minister.
Good,
right?
I picked up the accent, yeah. Either that or you're from Czechoslovakia.
Bloody hell. So my question is, like, at the end of your speech, you were talking about, like, the ability to construct international institutions in East Asia and the broader Pacific as a means to reduce tensions between the United States and China as on a whole. And yet, if what you're saying in your speech is the worldview of China and the U.S. and their visions of international order, whether from China a more conservative vision of international order and from the United States more liberal international vision, that in the constructing of international institutions, that both of them, that they will not reduce tensions, but they'll become an arena of conflict. And I wonder how you see that.
I suppose the way I see that is to say I disagree. And let me tell you why I disagree. Let's just reflect for a moment on the European precedents. I mean, the Europeans, you know, basically, from the wars of religion until 1945, succeeded in slaughtering each other over one issue or another for about 300 years. It really, it took between Westphalia and 1945 for the Europeans to work out this has not been entirely successful. They're slow learners, but they're effective learners. And look at the Franco-German relationship. Three slaughters within about half a century. Franco-Prussian War, First World War, Second World War. I mean, how many French and German bodies had to lie on the ground before someone worked out this was not a smart way to go? And so if you look at the statesmen from the period in the early 50s, they said, at one level, let's have a coal and steel agreement between France and Germany to deal with some objective elements in the relationship which had caused tensions in the past, namely the access by the Germans or the French to reliable coal supplies to fuel electricity production and the rest. But at a different level, the architects of the overall new strategic structure in Europe, people like then French Socialist Prime Minister in the late 40s, early 50s, Schumann, I think, the early work, of course, of Konrad Adenauer, one a French Socialist, the other a German Christian Democrat, was quite foundational because they worked out that this could not be repeated again. And so the coal and steel agreement evolved into what? It evolved into something broadly called, with a broader membership, the European Common Market. And then it evolved a decade or so later in something called the European Community. And then more recently, they called it the European Union. And some of the Federalists want to go further, despite all the reactions in Europe. One thing we do know in 2014, the prospect of France and Germany going to war again are remote. In fact, they don't exist. Now, I therefore argue that to you as a counterexample of a regional institution of some global note, namely the European Union. And despite all of its critics, and for all of its failings, it succeeded. Let me give you another example, ASEAN in Southeast Asia. I mean, there you go. They decide originally to create this thing involving five states, non-communist governments in Southeast Asia, to basically act as a bulwark against communist Indochina as it was feared to be unfolding. And then, that was the late 60s, then you evolved through the 70s, and then through the 80s and 90s, the membership is expanded from the original five to the entire Southeast Asian 10, so that now you have communist Vietnam with democratic Indonesia and whatever is now happening in Burma in a single entity. But what is the single remarkable thing about this entity? Since 1975 and the fall of Saigon, no one in Southeast Asia has gone to war with each other, with the exception of the Vietnamese-Cambodian War, at any level of magnitude. And so, yes, there are occasional border disputes. What they've evolved, however, is a culture of common security among themselves and a series of diplomatic modalities whereby when tensions arise, they seek to handle it. There was a minor breakout several years ago between Thailand and Cambodia. So the Indonesian foreign minister, my good friend Martin Atalagawa, there's 30 meetings either side of the border, eventually fixes it in a very ASEAN sort of way. Everyone gets a batik shirt at the end. And he's just very effective. I'm a great admirer of Marty and what he's done. But if you look at the recent history of Southeast Asia against what it was and to what it's become, think about the tempering impact of institutions. And so I go across to East Asia, where we have, frankly, a strategic zone central in terms of anything that could go wrong. North Korea, good grief. China, Japan, good grief. China, US, good grief. And so, and there's absolutely no architecture to temper any of this. I am not a utopian or a liberal idealist in the sense that I believe regional institutions solve all things. I'm not a Kantian idealist. I'm not seeking to construct the perfect peace. Kant may have done that in Königsberg on paper, but frankly, it's a little different elsewhere in the world. But I do know that if you rationally construct an institution with these sorts of intentionalities, which are to temper and to manage conflict over time, the probability of war is decreased. And what's the final point? Well, some of us work really hard to get America into one major regional institution in East Asia, which had a partial security mandate, and that's the East Asian Summit. It happened on my watch. And so now you have this institution, albeit nascent, with the 10 Southeast Asians, the 3 Northeast Asians, Australia, New Zealand, and India, and now the United States and Russia. So around a table of 18, you now have, frankly, those who represent the most likely corridors of strategic difficulty now and into the future. Therefore, how do you evolve that, as the Europeans did, from a nascent concept into something, frankly, in the direction of what I have long advocated, which is the evolution of an Asia-Pacific community, which, step by step, starts with small stuff like regional confidence and security-building measures, simple protocols for hailing one another at sea, hail and respond, hotlines between various regional militaries, and guess what? These, as we speak, are now being slowly rolled out. And so against all the stuff that's going wrong, here is one thing that can be made right, and coming out of nascent institutions, I think it needs to be formalized further, and here's the final point. If you have the Americans and the Chinese in this one regional institution, suddenly the rest of us who actually inhabit the region will express a view about the need to, frankly, make sure that the collective regional peace is observed and preserved. And that's not a bad thing either. So I try to combine a somewhat realist view of the world because of where I've worked in the past with also a reasonable degree of liberal institutionalism in the view, because I happen to think both traditions have something to offer in a constructive way for the future.
One more question from this side of the room. Yes, please.
Following up on your last remarks, and indeed your whole talk, I think it would be helpful if you would cite some specific constructive ways the two sides, China and the United States, have worked together in recent decades. I believe you would agree with me that the Chinese decision to join and participate in the World Trade Organization was absolutely central, and perhaps you could comment on that, and if you don't mind, a softball, and give other examples.
Oh, good.
Similar examples. Thank you.
I'll be brief because I'm conscious of the time. Climate change. I was in that room in Copenhagen in 2009 when world leaders came together to try and bring about a global agreement, binding agreement on climate change. I still bear the secular stigmata from that event. and that is, it was a very taxing experience. Only Catholics laughed at that joke, by the way. It was very hard for non-Catholics in the audience. Scar tissue is probably the best way of describing what I still bear. Sitting around in a tiny sort of what I describe as Danish minimalist architecture room with barely room to move, with 20 heads of government around an IKEA table and really badly put together IKEA chairs with, you know, President Obama there and and Gordon Brown, then Prime Minister of the UK, Merkel, everyone was there. The Chinese sent effectively a division head from the Chinese Foreign Ministry. This was not greeted well in that room. In fact, yes, many leaders were somewhat upset. And that was China's position then on climate change, which is, frankly, it's all your all you guys' problem. You're from the developed world. You created all this mess in the atmosphere. And it's a legitimate historical position, which is that you've achieved your development by emitting all these greenhouse gases over the last 150 to 200 years since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. Well, that's terrific. You're all now rich. You've terrific. You've put all this stuff up there. It degrades so slowly over time. You've achieved a virtual carbon limit, and now you're saying to the rest of us, sorry, too late. Stop. You can stay poor. Now, that's the Chinese perspective, and I understand it, as I do that of India and others, because it's inherently unjust in terms of the development curve. What our Chinese friends, however, have discovered in actually the last 3 years is that's an unsustainable position against their own environmental future. It's not just the air quality in Beijing, where I was last week at 400 plus, by the way, so I'm glad all you Chinese folks are here and not in Beijing. It's the equivalent of smoking a packet of Camel cigarettes a day, I think. It felt like it anyway. The Chinese are now acting for national reasons, but acting, and therefore, to go to your question, when President Obama meets President Xi Jinping in Beijing next month for a day's worth of meetings following the APEC summit, I hope and expect that there will be a joint declaration on climate change. I hope and expect that China will be able to announce a peaking year for its emission of greenhouse gases. I hope and expect that there will be a number attached to that as well, as China seeks now to work on constructing a global common good together with the United States, because between them, they represent 46%, 45% of total global greenhouse gas emissions. That is not a small matter. That's a big matter. We'll have to see the detail in terms of what the Chinese measures will be, but what I do know is that China, while doing this for national reasons, is seeking also to be very mindful of its international obligations as well. I thank you for listening.
And that brings us to the end of today's event. We've reached our time. I want to once again express on behalf of the Center and all of my colleagues our thanks to Paul and Mary Neuhauser. I want to express thanks to you for coming, and most sincerely to Mr. Kevin Rudd for another remarkable lecture in this wonderful series. The bar is open. And I invite you to adjourn off to the reception that has been prepared for you outside. Again, thank you very much, and thank you very much, Kevin.